What was the revolutionizing secret that enabled medieval builders to reach skyscraping heights? Many of the basic laws of physics were established years later, and material science was basically non-existent at that time. Yet, hundreds of years later, we still observe some of their brilliance encoded in these medieval giants. Check out their simple secret that requires no knowledge of physics or mathematics. Throughout the history of humankind, there has been a continual quest to build higher. Ancient civilizations built enormous monuments to honor their gods and kings, starting with the Egyptian pyramids, Greek and Roman temples, and so on. However, the materials, the engineering, and construction techniques available 3,000 years ago could only go to a certain limit. It was common for structures from that time to have a larger base to distribute the loads to a larger area. The Great Pyramid of Giza held the title for tallest structure for nearly 4,000 years. During the Middle Ages, several cathedrals overtook the title of tallest structure in the world, but most of them did not last and ended up collapsing. Cathedrals were built with high ceilings to give a feeling of monumentality and absolute power of God above everything else. However, building tall structures was not an easy feat 600 years ago. The laws of motion had not been established yet, so building cathedrals was more of a trial and error rather than actual design work. And additionally, builders from the Middle Ages did not have the same materials available as we do today. Building any type of structure without steel or concrete is already a difficult task. Steel can be shaped in many different forms, and it's strong compared to other materials. To put that into perspective, a bar made out of steel can handle about 5 times more load than the same bar made out of wood. On top of that, in the Middle Ages, pressure treatment methods were not available, so the wooden structures were highly susceptible to rotting, which was not great for cathedrals that were supposed to last hundreds of years. The only other material they had at their disposal was masonry stones. Masonry stones, or blocks, perform extremely well in compression, and were great for gravity-bearing members like columns and arches. Most cathedrals used stone blocks at the base, which were heavy and hard to overturn. Strong binding materials, like concrete, were not available, so blocks were often stacked on top of one another with little to no tensile resistance. Stones performed poorly when subjected to tension loads. Gravity loads from the roof would create lateral forces that would push the walls outwards and initiate a collapse mechanism. Larger walls could solve this issue, but that would drastically increase the amount of material needed and would block potential openings in the walls for windows, which were also essential for medieval cathedrals. And this is where the flying buttress comes into play. Buckling of the walls under high gravity loads was a common failure in medieval cathedrals. To prevent buckling, many of the cathedrals used flying buttresses as lateral support systems. The flying buttress can be seen on nearly all cathedrals from that time, which is part of the reason why they're still standing. The concept of the flying buttress is extremely simple and fairly effective. It transfers lateral loads to the ground using inclined compression arches. Looking closer to the connection system, it can be seen that when lateral loads are applied, one side of the wall experiences tensile forces. With reinforced concrete, this issue can be easily solved by providing steel reinforcement in the tensile side of the member. However, concrete was not available in medieval times, so builders added the flying buttress that in a clever way avoided unwanted tensile behavior. The buttresses were usually made large and heavy, so they themselves don't overturn. Sometimes, additional weight was placed on top of them in the form of decorative spires. This way, the medieval builders managed to avoid tensile behavior within the structure. Modern buildings do not employ this method in resisting lateral loads. The disadvantage of the buttress is that it requires additional space, making the base of the building fairly large. Most common lateral resisting systems today are steel bracing, moment frames, or concrete shear walls, all of which can be integrated within the building and go by unnoticed by most non-engineering visitors. Thank you for watching. Next time you're around one of these monumental buildings, try locating the flying buttress and imagine the transfer of loads. And of course, don't forget to like and subscribe. See you next time.